When the expelled students refused to leave their dorms, Wagner determined to make the expulsion of the students a civil matter. Students were served and ordered to show cause. At the time, a temporary restraining order was filed in Brooklyn Federal Court to block the college's order to show cause. While the restraining order was denied soon after, the federal court left open the potential to file suit challenging the constitutionality of the expulsion. The NAACP Legal Defense and Educational Fund represented the students.
We as students have rights, and I remember thinking this to myself, and I called the NAACP Legal Defense Fund and asked them for assistance. And Margaret Burnham and Jonathan Shapiro were the two attorneys that walked us through and helped us in the pursuit of justice.
I think that there was a certain intangible within the leadership of Black Concern at that time that said, we're not quitters, we're here for the duration. You might have expelled me, but the battle isn't over.
The students contended in their court filing that the expulsion is part of a practice of harassment and distrust of the Black students by the college administration because they are Black. White students have done the same thing in the past and have not been expelled or subjected to similar penalties.
We ended up in the Court of Appeals, and there was a panel of three judges that overturned the first ruling and actually kicked it back to the college.
While at Kent State University, four students were shot down by Ohio National Guardsmen, the nine-member Wagner Faculty Council began its own appeal hearings for Black Concern members. About 120 white students began a new occupation of President Davidson's office on May 13th, demanding that the college reinstate the 27 expelled students. However, despite their support, no decision was made concerning the 27 Black students. Finally, on May 21st, Wagner's Faculty Council began hearings, first taking testimony from Dean Haas and Dean Marr. During 2 hours of testimony, Haas recalled his ordeal. He said he was convinced that he was not allowed to leave, although not physically threatened. He issued a personal plea that the expulsions be modified by the Faculty Council. Dean Marr agreed during his testimony. I don't think the expulsion is the answer. Both sides here, administration and students, are guilty of not listening to each other. Among those testifying to the Faculty Council was Philip Stranieri.
You know, nothing happened to us the year before when we occupied the office, and we were in there with Dean Haas, and he was, you know, spoke to us and didn't feel threatened and things like that. So we didn't think that they should punish anybody this year either.
The following day, the Faculty Council voted to rescind the expulsion of the students, favoring suspension ending June 1st, but the students would lose credit for the spring semester's work. Ray Hodge was a star. His extraordinary basketball career produced nearly 2,000 points, a Seahawk record at the time. He was set to graduate in 1970, but he put everything on the line because he deeply believed in Black Concern. On May 31st, in response to a petition from 24 of the suspended students, the Faculty Council reversed its decision that would have blocked Ray Hodge's graduation. Hodge, an economics major, had continued to attend classes during his expulsion and had also taken final exams in his classes. Despite the ensuing struggles, the original demands of Black Concern and Almer were still relevant. President Davidson soon announced the appointment of Michael Kelly as Director of Special Programs. Kelly, a 1966 graduate who had coached Black Concern members Lonnie Brandon, Jake Ellis, and Howie Wilkinson, was interviewed for the post by members of Black Concern. As the fall 1970 semester began, the college hired William Nelson as special assistant to the Director of Admissions, specifically to recruit minority students. And by mid-October, Wagner appointed Sierra Leone-born Delphine Cisse as an instructor in the English department focusing on journalism. She had taught Afro-American heritage courses at Allegheny Community College the previous year.
You know, it was a time in history when we were discovering who we were. And, you know, our curiosity ran deep.
I think there's a scar. I think it was the learning opportunity of a lifetime.
The point that they seem to misinterpret is that times were changing, and now you had young men and women of minority stature looking for more than just being there.
I think this is a significant event in the history of Wagner, what happened in 69 and 70. And I think it's good that people understand what went on. I think probably most students don't know, have any idea about it, so.
I would think whenever your ideas are challenged in a big way, you can't really go back to being exactly who you are again. You know, that doesn't mean you grow as much as you might need to, but I don't think you can stay exactly the same. So I think that's why diversity is so important. It challenges your thinking and invites you to consider more than you would with just your blinders on.
Your soul intact.